Welcome. In this video, I'll be diving into the Red Hat Advanced Cluster Security for Kubernetes product roadmap, also known as what's next in ACS. Of course, with every product roadmap comes the disclaimer that the content presented is for informational purposes only. Timelines, features, and priorities are all subject to change without notice. Now, in this what's next for ACS video, there are 9 major topics that I want to cover, from vulnerability management to ACS cloud service and more. All the timestamps are below if you want to skip to a specific section. Each section will be broken down into 3 subsections. The near-term updates are slated for less than 6 months, mid-term updates are approximately around 9 months delivery time, and long-term updates are a year out or greater. Now, with every new ACS release comes a new support cadence. ACS full support begins at the general availability of the minor version and ends after a 6-month period, in which case maintenance support kicks in. And we expect every ACS user to keep their environments up to the most current supported microversion. I'll leave some notes in the description below if you want to take a full look at the support cadence in the OpenShift operator lifecycle. The ServiceNow integration for vulnerability response will be available soon. It lets users create custom workflows to assign remediation tasks to the right owners with the goal of automating that process through a 2-way connection. After that, we're adding vulnerability reporting for virtual machines running on OpenShift. This strengthens security for VM workloads since ACS will scan both virtual machines and containers for vulnerabilities. We're also enriching vulnerability data with the CISA-maintained Known Exploited Vulnerabilities Catalog, or CISA-KEV. That means ACS will prioritize fixing issues that are actively being exploited and pull in real-time updates from the CISA-KEV catalog, along with CVSS and EPSS scores. In the midterm, ACS will help teams identify the base image layer in container images so it's clear who is responsible for fixing which part. We'll also add the ability to import a software bill of materials, or SBOMs, and export vulnerability reports, making it easier to track down vulnerabilities across different sources and generate more detailed reports. In the long term, we're going to add AI-based CVE prioritization. ACS will generate an exploit score using an explainable AI model, helping teams focus on the most critical threats. We're also adding image mode for RHEL vulnerability scanning with ACS in CI/CD pipelines, so security checks are built into that development process. This will also allow ACS to detect vulnerabilities in RHEL-based images and application layers separately. Finally, we're adding Zstream-based remediation guidance for OpenShift, which means ACS will track Red Hat's weekly security patches and provide up-to-date advice on how to remediate risks in OpenShift images. On to policy and violation management. In the near term, we'll make the Splunk integration easier by consolidating the 2 existing methods into one. We'll also make small updates to policy as code, like supporting names by UUID, and move the CRD API from alpha to stable. This follows the GA of policy as code in 4.8. In the midterm, we plan to give users the option to prevent drift by only allowing policies as code. This will also cover ACS default system policies. And in the long term, we want to expand policy as code to better support GitOps ecosystems beyond just custom resources, so it works for a wider range of customer needs. We're also enhancing the policy engine to work with GitOps tools that use different approaches, such as Flux, and even CI/CD native tools, such as GitHub. Another goal is to refine the policy model by splitting policy definitions from their behavior, meaning rules would be separate from things like notifiers and enforcements. Finally, we're exploring integration with other policy engines, such as Kiverno, with the UI for this integration becoming part of OpenShift instead of just ACS. On to risk and configuration management, where we're working on using AI to deliver risk recommendations for deployments. Building on our current integration with Red Hat Developer Hub for vulnerability insights, we plan to expand this to cover all types of security risks. These AI-driven recommendations will use the ACS APIs together with large language models to show insights directly in the ACS dashboard, similar to how OpenShift Lightspeed integrates today. Looking further ahead, ACS already provides valuable insights into role-based access controls within a cluster. We want to take this further by giving customers a more graphical view of RBAC controls, making it much easier to understand and assess permissions across their clusters. On to compliance. Now, since last year, ACS has offered a compliance experience across OpenShift clusters by integrating with the compliance operator. Many of our users use the tailored profiles in the compliance operator, and they want the ability to schedule these through ACS. Tailored profiles let customers focus on specific controls that matter to them, even if controls span multiple benchmarks. We'll be adding the ability in ACS to both schedule these scans and visualize the results. OpenShift virtualization is now a reality, and earlier this year, Red Hat released the first OpenShift virtualization hardening guide. A new profile based on that guide will be available in the compliance operator, and ACS customers will be able to automatically assess and continuously monitor their OpenShift virtualization environments against it. And in the long term, we want ACS to enable customers to trigger multi-cluster remediation automatically directly through ACS. On to runtime and networking, where we're enhancing our suspicious process detection to provide automatic alerts without manual intervention. Users will be notified as soon as processes deviate from the baseline without needing to lock in the baseline first. To avoid alert fatigue, these policies will be disabled by default, giving customers the choice to enable them if they want to receive notifications. In the midterm, ACS will introduce a new capability, file activity monitoring. This will track not only files accessed inside containers, but also in the host file system. With this feature, security teams can quickly spot abnormal behavior, such as unauthorized file access or potential data exfiltration attempts. In the long term, we plan to expand automatic alerting to cover suspicious network execution, introduce an advanced process baseline to help manage large numbers of deployments without manual effort, and extend the network graph to include new isolation types, such as admin network policies, baseline admin network policies, and user-defined networks. Onto the UX and Red Hat portfolio side, we're focusing on two key areas. First, we're building an OpenShift console plugin that integrates directly into the OpenShift web console. This will give users a smoother experience for security, observability, and cluster management. Second, we'll expose Prometheus metrics to enable advanced monitoring, custom dashboards, and stronger alerting. This makes it easier to segment and track different security layers and workflows. In the midterm, we're aiming for deeper portfolio integration and more advanced capabilities. This includes strengthening cluster security through OCP, ACM, and ACS integration, moving the developer hub workflow to GA with a focus on vulnerabilities, and exploring Lightspeed AI capabilities to help operationalize ACS. We'll also add declarative control of ACS settings with GitOps so users can manage configuration as code. In the long term, our goal is seamless authentication and authorization between OpenShift and ACS, creating a more unified security and management experience. We also plan to expand the developer hub workflow to help developers quickly find and fix policy violations within their applications, while taking a risk-driven approach to highlight the most critical attack paths and exposures in their environments. On to hardening and platform support, where in the near term, ACS will automate the rotation of internal TLS certificates used for secure communication between components. This removes the need for manual renewals, making it much easier for customers managing many secured clusters. It also addresses compliance and operational pain points highlighted by customer feedback. In the midterm, we're introducing initial support for post-quantum cryptographic algorithms for digital signatures, aligning with the NIST roadmap and preparing ACS for future cryptographic standards. We'll also improve cluster registration by replacing bootstrap credentials with short-lived, limited-use credentials. This configurable expiration ensures credentials are only used for registration, reducing the risk of misuse or extended validity. Long-term, we'll expand post-quantum support to include additional algorithms for digital encryption, ensuring ACS remains resilient as cryptographic standards evolve. We'll integrate with Spire, using SPIFFI IDs to authenticate communication between central and sensor components, simplifying secure cluster registration and strengthening authentication. Finally, ACS will support installation in IPv6-only environments. Onto ACS Cloud Service, where in the midterm, we're focusing on ACS Cloud Service self-service capabilities. These features will let customers manage and configure their ACS Cloud instance on their own, giving them more control and reducing the need for support with routine configurations. Looking further ahead, our long-term goals include FedRAMP certification for ACS Cloud Service, making it available on GovCloud to meet federal compliance standards. We also plan to make ACS Cloud Service available in Azure Marketplace, simplifying procurement and deployment for customers using Microsoft Azure while expanding accessibility on a widely used platform. And on to the last topic, ecosystem. In the near term, ACS will support using credentials and secrets managed by external secret stores like Vault. Customers on Kubernetes clusters can create secrets in an ACS namespace, which are then managed by tools such as the External Secrets Operator, Secret Store CSI Driver, or Vault Secret Operator. These integrate with external credential managers like HashiCorp Vault. ACS then reads these secrets to authenticate with external applications and tools. For example, the CSI driver can load the secret into a specific path in ACS Central and refresh it every 2 minutes, ensuring ACS always uses the latest credentials for external API access. In the midterm, ACS integrates with Red Hat Trusted Artifact Signer for keyless signature verification, supporting secure trusted software supply chain workflows. In the future, we plan to extend this support to edge and disconnected clusters where mirror registries are used. Thank you for watching, and thank you for all of the product feedback from the community and from our users. We really appreciate it, and we hope to see you in the next What's New video for ACS with ACS 4.9.